mission to find a way to live a more sustainable life. And I've already looked at the future of our fridge and the future of meat production. But now I want to see if there's a way we can generate enough energy to power our own commutes. After all, predictions on fossil fuel reserves indicate that we've only got 115 years left of coal production and only 50 years of oil and natural gas remain. So we've got to look for alternative options. So how does this all work then? I'm revisiting the Centre for Alternative Technology in Wales to find out for myself. I've been trying to find ways in which I might be able to power my own commute in the future.
It's quite difficult for individuals to be totally self-sufficient from an energy point of view. You can put solar panels on your own roof and contribute to your own electricity usage, or you could buy your own electric car. But of an evening, you would have to plug that electric car into your house electricity system to recharge it. So you need to be thinking about where that electricity is coming from at all times, really, to be truly self-sufficient.
And that's a huge personal investment as well.
It is. It's relatively expensive to put PV panels on your own roof, and not everybody's house is facing the right direction either.
Can you explain how PV, how solar panels work?
Okay, cool. So behind you, you can see large solar roof made up of lots of individual solar panels.
Yeah.
When the sun shines on them, they generate electricity at DC.
Okay.
Okay. Now we can then take that DC and we can turn it into AC electricity, which is what most people have coming out of the sockets in their house.
Uh-huh.
And we can either use it in our houses or we can export it straight back to the grid.
Okay. And then we have to use something to get it from DC to AC.
Okay. Yeah. There's a device called an inverter which turns that DC power into AC power.
I'm in Brighton, home of the Big Lemon, the UK's first fleet of solar buses. This is an entirely electric bus. Yeah. Also notice little USB points.
Yeah.
Is that solar as well?
Yeah, the whole bus is solar energy. We have 128 solar panels on the roof of our bus depot.
Okay.
And that produces 21 kilowatts of power.
What does that mean?
This bus and another one very similar.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, they run 52 service, which the other bus is doing at the moment.
Yes. So you know that with these two buses on that route, those solar panels will give you enough energy to be able to do that entirely without relying on other sources. How do projects like this benefit the community?
Oh, in a million ways. The bus service itself is very important to people on the outskirts of town. For a lot of people, we are their lifeline into town. Running on electric means that they are zero emissions. Brighton has a massive air quality problem, and as so many cities and towns in the country. We're also sharing as much of the data as we can so that other bus operators can also learn from this trial, if you like, and then hopefully it will accelerate the change to zero emission buses across the country.
What are the disadvantages of something like this?
It's a hugely expensive thing to set up.
Yeah, initially.
Yeah, I think it changes the economics quite a lot in terms of much bigger investment to start with, and then the actual running costs are a lot cheaper.
Let's talk stats.
Yeah.
How long does the bus take to charge and how long will it run for?
It goes from naught to about 99
in
That's percent, not miles per hour.
If only.
In 6.5 hours.
Okay.
And then that runs it for about 100 miles. And on the routes that we run in Brighton and Hove, that lasts about 10 hours.
What are you saving? What are the benefits?
Yeah, that's massive. So if it's obviously with the renewable energy, it saves 140 kilograms of CO2 every day.
Every day?
Yeah.
At the moment, you've got two buses in the fleet. Are you hoping to expand that at all?
Yeah, well, we've actually got two full-size buses this size and an electric minibus as well, runs like smaller shuttles. But in 2 weeks' time, we are getting four more buses of the same size, but they're brand new, fully purpose-built electric. And we'll be getting more solar panels to power them by middle of March. We'll be running all our six Brighton Hove routes with electric buses powered by renewables. And we hope that in the future, we can then expand that further afield and do that in other towns as well.
Welcome to Groningen in the north. So So we're here to check out a solar road. This is a prototype bike path that uses energy from the sun to feed a charging unit for all sorts of different gadgets, including electric bikes. But as you can see, we've picked the perfect day for it. The solar road outside, how much electricity is it generating?
It is generating approximately 3,500 kilowatt hours per year.
What could that charge?
One Dutch household, which can then be powered by 10 meters of road. If we would cover one third of our road network with this type of technology, with solar road, we could power 8 million electric cars, and that is equal to the total amount of cars that we have today.
Can you tell me a little bit about how it works?
It is a solar panel integrated into a road, and it catches the sunlight and converts it to electricity. And the difference with regular solar panels is that these are very sturdy, very strong.
Yeah, I felt them. They're gritty.
They're gritty, and that's important because you have to have a safe road for the road users. But underneath there is, well, it's a different solar panel than what you put on a rooftop typically. It's more sturdy, it's more more strong, heavily designed. But actually, it works like a regular solar panel.
That gritty top layer, it provides grip, but that doesn't make them any less efficient.
Slightly.
Okay.
I mean, it is, of course, a little bit of a compromise that you have to make between using it as a road and using it as a solar panel. So
right.
The electricity from the road is fed into a battery that's next to the road, and that is connected to a charging station. So what people do, this is located next to a bike road that is regularly used by a lot of people. When they want to rest here, then they can charge their smartphone, their tablet, but also their e-bike if they have an e-bike. But in other projects, we connect it to the grid, for instance, to power the lighting, the public lighting that is next to the road. And then the balancing, so when there is a surplus of energy generated by the road, it's going into the grid, and when there is more electricity needed than the road is providing, we can get it from the grid. So the grid works as a kind of a balancing system.
And I guess in that type of situation, actually, the generating the electricity ends up benefiting the whole community.
Absolutely.
If we were to create an entire bike path, would you imagine every inch of it would be solar panel, or would it just be in chunks?
We estimate that between 20 and 30% of the total roads suitable for application of this type of technology.
When you look ahead to the future of this, you're talking about changing the entire road network of a country. How do you feel being part of a project that has such long-term goals? Is that frustrating?
Sometimes, of course, when you see that the steps that you want to take are not achievable at that moment. But on the other hand, we have to think about long-term here. And it fits actually quite well, because you see that roads have a very regular maintenance program. When you tap into these moments to make the decision either to go with this technology or not, and you program that actually, then you can program your whole transition of going from regular roads to solar roads in a very organized way.
Find out more on how you can live sustainably, watch the other videos in this series, and don't forget to subscribe.